I don't care how late you stay out. Stay out as late as you want. You want to borrow the new car? You want to borrow my credit card? Kids today, they really have it rough. I have no idea where we are or where we're going.
I mean, when I was their age, life was easy, super easy.
Why haven't you gotten a tattoo yet? How come you don't have any piercings yet?
Yep, we're lost. We are completely lost.
Ooh, sports.
Just do whatever the mechanic says to do.
Vehicle maintenance is completely overrated.
Look, whatever the mechanic is asking, just pay him. Pay him whatever he wants.
I wish they had soap operas at night. I like that boy. You should date him. You should date him immediately.
Well, what about the creepy guy with the motorcycle? He's cute.
Yeah, sure. Spring break in Tahiti sounds fun. Hey, make sure you get all your video games done before you start your homework.
You don't have to pass all your classes.
What? You have a project due tomorrow, and you've known about it for 4 weeks, and you haven't started yet? Sweet!
Doesn't anybody want to know if we're there yet?
Remember, if you need anything between midnight and 4 a.m., please come wake me up.
Hey, I'm on the phone. Could you bring the baby over and let him climb all over me?
Hey! Hey, can you please turn that music up?
Well, we just stopped for lunch 10 minutes ago, but yeah, let's stop again.
I never have trouble with my toddler.
I never have trouble with my teenagers.
I never have trouble with my adult children.
You know, she's right. We are ruining her life.
Yes, more homework to correct.
All right, whining.
Yay, tantrums.
Vomit.
We just really need to spoil these kids more.
Sorry, buddy. I don't know any good jokes at all.
You're 16. You pretty much know everything now.
I think 18 is a great age to get married.
Okay, remember, make sure you turn on all the lights before you leave the house. Hey, could you leave the front door open for a couple hours? Thanks.
Whoa! Money really does grow on trees.
Thank you. Good morning. Happy Father's Day. Will all the fathers please stand? Let's give them a hand. Thank you, guys. You know, we bought the ladies a rose for Mother's Day. And what I tried to find was just the stem without the rose. They wouldn't say. I just thought that'd be appropriate. But thank y'all for being here this morning. If you're visiting with us, we welcome you. And you're going to hear me talk about, over the next few weeks, about unity in our church. And you're going to get tired of hearing it, but we're still going to talk about it. We've got to be unified. We're in a time where our church has to have unity, where our church has to pray. You say, what can I do? Hey, we got to pray. All the time. If this church would pray and be unified, if God called Dustin to go to Church Hill, he's called somebody to come to sleep. And it's just a matter of us finding that somebody. And we're already working on it. On Wednesday nights, we're back to having, I guess you call it a prayer meeting. But we're going to pray on Wednesday nights. And we'll have a devotional, but we're going to pray a lot. The deacons will leave from here, and we pray. And we're going to be working on this coming up. So we'll be looking at what we need to do over the next few weeks. We're going to have some different people here to preach to us. So just keep that in mind. On the back of your bulletin, there's a list of deacons. And there's phone numbers. If you have something that you need, call one of us. That's what we're here for. It may be moving a piano, Mike McBride. But call us, and we'll try to work out what needs to be done in your life. But I told my Sunday school class this morning, you know, preachers used to say you got to be prayed up. We got to be prayed up. We got to be ready for what's coming over the next few months or whatever time it's going to take. But in the meantime, we're going to carry on. The Bible's still going to be preached here. It's going to start today with Tyler. And we'll have others. But just remember and pray. And on that note, I'm going to ask Mark Roberts if he will to pray for us this morning. I just saw you back there, Mark. Either way you want to do it.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to come into your house again. What a blessed and joyful time it is to gather together and to worship you in spirit and in truth. Father, I ask for your Holy Spirit to live among us. Father, I know that you will be leading the way as this church is up to the next man to lead them. And Father, we just thank you for the leadership of your Holy Spirit. Father, we thank you for all the guidance that you provide and the joy that you provide in the journey. Father, we pray that your Holy Spirit will move among us as we worship you this morning. Father, we pray that as Tyler has prepared his heart, that Father, you would just fill him with your Spirit and your words to bless us today. And Father, there is someone here today that has a decision to make for you. We pray for their surrender to your will. We love you, Father. We thank you for loving us. Thank you, Father, for Sneeple First Baptist Church. For it's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Mark. Mark's got where when he sees my number, he says, oh, here he is again. So we're dependent on Mark a lot. So, okay, thank you. It's good to have him doing this. Now, the youth will not meet this Wednesday. The youth will meet this Wednesday.
This Wednesday.
But they'll be back the next. Okay. Okay. You won't make it difficult for me, aren't you? Yeah, it's all right. All right, the next two Wednesday nights, they will, the youth won't be here. KOW is going to be out for the summer, but the adults will be here in the sanctuary Wednesday night, okay? And everybody's invited to join us. And that's part of our prayer for this church, what we do on Wednesday night, so we look forward. If our ushers will come at this time, we'll receive the offering this morning. And I'm going to ask Jay, if he will, to pray over our offering. Can you do that for me? All right, thank you. Thank you.
to his name. Glory to his name.
Yeah.
Thank you all. I know we don't have to introduce him, but I just want to say a thing or two about Tyler. Our church appreciates Tyler. And we thank you. I told him the other day, when he preaches Sunday and Father's Day, and I said, you can preach to your daddy and your granddad. So they're here. Thank you all. I don't put no pressure on you, but go ahead.
Verse 1 says, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go in the house of the Lord. I tell you, it's good to be in the house of the Lord this morning, and I can already say it's been good to be here. And all our musicians and singers up here, I surely do appreciate, but I truly appreciate Junebug. He has a heart for the Lord. I wish I could have a heart for the lost, or heart to sing, heart to preach, like he's got. But I surely do appreciate him and all the other singers and musicians. But to me, we lost the best pastor out there. been called somewhere else. But Exodus chapter 14, verse 13 says, "Fear not, stand still, and see the salvation of the Lord." Listen, God's going to see us through. Before we can see it, He'll see us through. We've got to be in His Word. And like David said, we've got to be much in prayer. And not only just say it or just speak it, we actually have to mean it. If our prayers are void and we truly don't mean it, it ain't going to get anywhere. We're truly going to have to mean it. But happy Father's Day. I'm glad my dad and my papa's here. Dad's the best dad out there, in my opinion. Of course, I disagree with him a lot. But the older I get, the more I realize how much he is right. They've been a perfect example to me, both godly men, but also how to work, how to be a good husband, a good friend, and I'm truly thankful for them. And of course, my brother, he's a soon-to-be dad, and I know he'll be a great dad too. But I know I'm not a dad this morning, and I'm going to be speaking to you fathers. I can't say I am a cat dad. It's about 14 weeks old right now, and it's already in the teenager stage. Can't get him to listen to nothing. But we're going to be in several different places today. But our main scripture is going to be in Deuteronomy chapter 6. If y'all want to be turning your Bible, I know that a couple times ago we preached in Deuteronomy chapter 6, but we're going to get a little different take on it this morning. And last time I preached on memorial stones. Also, little lambs can go down. Bernice and Elise is going to take them down. But last week we preached on memorial stones, and I forgot to mention that Sunday that I preached made 5 years since I announced my calling to preach. And I've been keeping up ever since that I've been preaching. I'm sure I missed a few. But I think it was close to 60 different churches somewhere around that area, in Virginia, Tennessee, about everywhere around here. And it made the 100th time that I stood behind this pulpit to preach. So that was a memorial stone in my life that I forgot to mention, and it's very dear to me. But we're going to be in Deuteronomy chapter 6. And before I begin in anything, I want to let you just listen to this verse. In 1 Samuel chapter 3, verse 10, it says, "Speak, Lord, thy servant heareth." This morning, I know I'm not a dad, and I know that it's hard for me to get up here and try to give you all advice. But all the advice that I'm going to give you today is coming from the Word of God. It's coming from the perfect Father, the good, good Father. And I pray that you all would just listen. And these stats that I'm about to give you are from about 2 years ago, and I'm sure they're much higher now, and I want you to just pay attention to them just for a minute. 63% of our youth suicides are from fathers' homes. 90% of all runaway children are from fathers' homes. 85% of all children with behavior disorders are from fathers' homes. 71% of high school drops out are from fathers' homes. 75% of adolescent chemical abuse patients in drug treatment centers are from fathers' homes. 85% of all youth in prison are from fathers' homes. And this may be shocking, but I tell you this morning, it's not surprising to me. Because how important a father is. And today's society is corrupt, and we know that, and they made the father's role to be belittled. But these stats that I've read off to you this morning ought to show you how important you fathers are. And I want you to listen to this. If a father does not go to church, even if the wife does, only one child in 50 will become a worshiper. I think the highest statistic that I found, or percentage, was 15% of the kids, when their father don't go to church, will go to church. Only 15%. And if you're a single mother today and saying, "Well, what's that leave me?" Listen, God delights in doing exceptional things in the life of people that believe in Him. Do you believe Him to be that exceptional? Do you believe God's going to help you be that exception? And I know that I didn't say any of that to dishearten any mother today or any single parent. But today you can testify how difficult it is and how great God is and how faithful and loving He is to help you. So 15% of fathers that don't go to church, if fathers don't go to church, only 15% of their kids will. If the father does and the mother doesn't, 66% of the children will attend church. And when they both attend, it's 75%. So we're not talking about luxuries today of a father, but we're talking about the necessities of the father. We need godly men who are influential godly fathers. Let's look in Deuteronomy chapter 6. The first point I have today, if you want to write it down, and my title today is An Influential Father. And if you want to write this point down, an influential father leaves a legacy. Let's look in verse 1 here. It says, "Now these are the commandments in chapter 6, the statutes and the judgments which the Lord your God commanded to you to teach you, and that you might do them well in the land whether you go to possess it, that thou mightest fear the Lord thy God and keep all his statutes and his commandments which I command thee, thou and thy son and thy son's son, all the days of thy life, and that thy days may be prolonged." So as fathers, we must first be reminded of the priority of God's Word. And to do that, to remind our kids and to remind ourselves, we must first possess it. We must first have it in our hearts. We can't give nothing. We can't teach nothing if we don't already possess it. So we have to have it in our hearts, and we have to have a heart for God, and then it'll have a generational effect, as we'll see here in a minute. But in Joshua chapter 1, verse 8, it says, "This book of law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate there day and night, and thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein." So the first part of that verse, number 8 there, is saying you've got to get in the Word. You've got to get the Word of God in your heart. And then the second part, it says, "For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success." So when we get the Word of God in our hearts as fathers and as men of God, then the last part of that verse says, then God will bless you and make you successful. So we must first get the Word of God in our hearts. To leave a legacy as a father, to leave that great legacy behind, we have to have the Word of God in our hearts. And I'm not talking about a legacy of worldly things. And I'm not talking about leaving your sons a business or stocks or all kinds of money. Yes, that's a great thing to leave. But I'm talking about a legacy of knowing God, of loving God. And not only knowing God and loving God, but living for God. And so we see here in verse 2, it says, "That thou mightest fear the Lord thy God, and to keep all his statutes and his commandments." And it says if we keep those commandments, then it's going to have a generational effect. Let's look a little bit farther. "Which I command thee, thou and thy sons and thy sons' sons." So not only is it going to affect your life, your wife's life, but it's not only going to affect your son's life or your daughter's life, but it's also going to affect your grandkids and maybe your great-grandkids. It's going to have a generational effect. And in 1 Kings chapter 2, verse 1 through 4, we see there the dying words of David to his son Solomon. And let's turn there in 1 Kings chapter 2. 1 Kings chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. It says, "Now the days of David drew nigh that he should die, and he charged Solomon his son, saying..." So David is here on his deathbed, and he's wanting to tell his son Solomon a few things. In verse 2 it says, "I go the way of all the earth. Be strong, therefore, and show thyself a man, and keep the charge of the Lord thy God." So he's already telling his son right off the bat to keep pressing on, keep following God. Now, Solomon wouldn't have listened to that if David didn't do it himself. And so it says, "To walk in his ways, to keep his statutes and his commandments, his judgments, his testimonies, that is written in the law of Moses, that thou mayest prosper in all that thou doest, and whithersoever thou turn thyself, verse 4, that the Lord might may continue his word which he spake concerning me, saying, if thou child take heed to thy way, to walk before me in truth with all thy heart and with all thy soul, there shall not fail thee, said he, a man on the throne of Israel. So David's dying words here to his son Solomon is keep pressing on for the Lord. Now, would Solomon listen to him? If my dad was to tell me something, to do something, maybe keep living from God, and he never attended church, and he never taught me growing up, and he never set that example, do you think that I'm going to listen to him? Probably not. But my dad has. And if you want your children to listen to you, and if you want to leave that legacy behind, you must first live it. You must first be in the Word of God. You must first set an example of prayer. You must first set an example of coming to church every time the doors are open. But an influential father leaves a legacy. Second point, an influential father loves God intensely. Let's look in verse number 5 in Deuteronomy chapter 6. And verse 5 says, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God. So a father, if you want to be an influential father, you've got to love God. And I'm not talking about loving Him and thankful that you're saved, but I'm talking about physically just loving God. I mean, I love my wife, and I would do anything for her, but I love God. God's my number one. And if I love God fully, and I give my life to God fully, then I'm going to love my wife more. And then you as fathers, if you love God fully and give Him your whole heart, as we'll see here in just a second, then you're not only going to love your wife more, but you're going to love your kids more. And there's three things that I'm talking about love here. In verse 5 it says, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thine heart. I'm talking about a committed love. With all thine heart. And it says, and with all thy soul. I'm talking about a selfless love. And if you want to look at selfless love, you can look where you spend your time. You can look what's on your calendars. And you can look what you give. Are you selflessly loving God with all your heart and with all your soul? And last we'll see, with all thy mind. I'm talking about a strong love. And you can't pass something on to your kids you don't have. You must first love God before you can pass the love of God on to kids. I'm rolling through these points. Point number 3, an influential father lives with a spiritual intentionality. Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 6 through 7, it says, and these words which I command thee this day shall be in thine heart, and thou shalt teach them diligently and to thy children. So we're supposed to impress the Word of God on our kids. You're responsible to imprint that in their lives. And a lot of times it's made out to be mine and Jill's role to do that. But we're actually there to help you do that. You're the main disciple of your kids, fathers and mothers. And if you want your kids to be blessed in life, it's going to come from the Word of God. But how do you do this? How do you live with spiritual intensity? So first, conventionally, we talk about what we feel really strong about. I can talk to anybody about anything, but I can really talk when I feel strong about it. You might not get a word in. And that's how everybody is. Our convictions even determine our decisions. Verse 6 says, it shall be on our hearts. The Word of God, we must be passionate about it as fathers. We must get the Word of God in our hearts. And like I even mentioned before, you can't teach what you don't know. And you can't teach what you're not passionate about. So before, as fathers, before we can teach the Word of God, we must be passionate about it. We must be in it ourselves. But not only conventionally, but consistent. And it says, thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children. And shalt talk of them when thou sittest in thine house, and when thou walkest by the way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up. So we're supposed to be discipling. And I look back when I was preparing this message, we have some kids up there that really love to come to church. Why is that? Because their parents was consistent. When you're consistent, you ain't got to worry about if your kid wants to come to church or not. If you're consistent, you ain't got to worry about if your kid's going to read their Bible or not. If you're consistent, you ain't got to worry about if they're going to pray before they go to bed and when they wake up. Why? Because they seen that distilled in you. It says, teach them diligently, everywhere. But how do we do that? By conversation. Verse number says, and thou shalt talk with them. And I'm not talking about when a kid comes up and says, hi, Dad, how's it going? Psalms 23. I'm not talking like that. No, when they come up and say, hi, Dad, how's it going? Well, Lord bless me today, it's going good. And when they have a problem, you tie it to the Bible. What does God say about that? And they're going to have a lot of questions. They're going to come up to you. And a question is about the Bible when you're consistent and you've instilled conversation with them. They're going to have a lot of questions, and a lot of questions are going to be hard, and you may not answer, but there's a thing called Google. Don't just say, hey, yeah, go Google that and figure it out. When you find out, I'd like to know too, so tell me. No, sit down with them. Say, we're going to find this out. Even if I have to Google it and say, do it with them. Be consistent. And talk with them and relate things to spiritual outcomes. So if you want to be an influential father with spiritual intentionality, you got to be convicted about it. You got to be consistent about it. You got to have conversation. And influence, we're going to start turning through the Bible right here in just a few minutes. An influential father also prays for the children. In John chapter 4, verse 46 through 49, a Roman guard comes up to Jesus. His son was sick. He comes up to Jesus and says, Jesus, will you, I'm paraphrasing, I'm not quoting, Jesus, will you heal my son? My son is sick. I've tried everything. Will you please heal my son? And guess what Jesus done? Jesus healed his son. But an influential father brings their kids to Jesus. We cannot physically now just say, Jesus, here's my son, lay him at his feet and he'll heal him physically. But guess what? Every time that we go to prayer, we're laying things at his feet. And just as this man physically come up to Jesus for his son to be healed, we can go up to Jesus and Jesus will do the exact same thing for us as he did this Roman guard. We have to bring, or you have to bring, I ain't got kids, I'll bring my cat, but you have to bring your kids to Jesus. You have to lay them at his feet. But not only do you need to pray for your children, but you need to believe that God can do great things in and around your family. Luke chapter 1, verse 5 through 15. This is when an angel comes to Zechariah and his wife to tell them about their child, John the Baptist, being born. So they was old. Zechariah did not believe that God could do this. He did not believe that this was going to happen, but guess what? It happened. John the Baptist come. And just like us, we may not believe that and a few things, and we're really struggling with our faith, and we're really struggling that God can do things in our family and in our lives and in our children's lives, but guess what? God can. And we have to believe that. To be an influential father, we have to pray for our kids and believe that God is going to do it. But not only do we need to do those things, but we need to train up and disciple. Proverbs chapter 22, verse 6, it says, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. And there's a lot of people here where I've preached many times about how parents are the number one disciple of the kids. Well, guess what? We looked at those statistics back at the beginning of the message, but I guess listen. Without a father, kids are going to stray. Kids are going to have a hard time. They ain't even going to grow up to be church members. a lot of them, 15%. So as a father, you have to train up your child. You have to disciple your child. Eli, if you look at him in 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 22 through 26, I'll read this for you. But Eli failed to disciple, and we're about to see what happened. So in verse number 20, beginning 22, it says, "Now Eli was very old and heard that his sons did unto all Israel, and how they lay with the women that assembled at the door of the tabernacle of the congregation." So as Eli didn't disciple, he was hearing of all these things that his kids was doing, even at the door of the tabernacle. And he said unto them, "Why do you do such things? For I hear your evil dealing by all these people. Nay, my sons, for it is no good report that I hear you make the Lord's people transgress. If one man sin against another, the judge shall judge him. But if a man sin against the Lord, who shall entreat for him? Notwithstanding, they hearken not unto his voice of the father, because the Lord would slay them." So Eli was telling them this, and they didn't hearken to the father. They did not scare him. But I tell you, there was many times I did not listen to my dad, and my dad was consistent. If he told me to do something or told me not to do something, I done it. I got punished for it. But Eli didn't. And it says, "And the child Samuel grew and was in favor both with the Lord and also with men." We see we can't be in favor with men and also the Lord. We can't be straddling the fence. "And there came a man of God unto Eli and said to him, Thus saith the Lord, did I plainly appear into the house of the father when they were in Egypt in Pharaoh's house." So a man of God came unto Eli and was telling him what the Lord told him. "And did I choose him out of all the tribes of Israel to be my priest, to offer unto mine altar, to burn incense, to wear antipod before me? And did I give unto the house of the father all the offerings made by fire of the children of Israel? Wherefore kick ye at my sacrifice and at my offering, which I commanded in my habitat, and honor is thy sons above me, to make yourselves fat with the chiefest of all the offerings of the children of the Israel, my people." So here he's saying, this man of God, which God spoke to him, now he's speaking to Eli, is saying that you put your sons before me. And this is what's causing all this disobedience. Because when you follow God and you set that example, then they're going to follow you and listen to you. And it says, "Wherefore," verse 30, "Wherefore the Lord God of Israel saith, I said indeed that thy house and the house of the father shall walk before me forever. But now the Lord saith, but it is far from me, for them that honor me I will honor, and they that despise me shall be lightly esteemed. Behold, the days come that I will cut off thine arm in the arms of thy father's house, and thou shalt not be an old man in thine house. And thou shalt see an enemy in my habitation, and all the wealth with God shall give Israel, and thou shalt be an old man in thy house forever. And the man of thine whom I shall not cut off from my altar shall be consumed thine eyes, and to grieve thine heart, and to the increase of the house of the Lord shall die in the fire of their age. And this shall be a sign unto thee that shall come upon thy sons in the day they shall die, both of them." So we see here that Eli didn't train or disciple his kids. His kids was disobedient to God, and now they're being cut off. Not only do we need to train up, pray for them, and believe, but we also got to fear the Lord God ourselves. In Psalms 112, verses 1 through 10, it says, "Praise ye the Lord. Blessed is a man that feareth the Lord, that delighteth greatly in his commandments. His seed shall be mighty upon the earth, the generation of the upright shall be blessed. Wealth and riches shall be in the house, and his righteousness endureth forever. Unto the upright there ariseth light in the darkness. He is gracious and full of compassion and righteous. A good man showeth favor and lendeth. He will guide his affairs with discretion. Surely he shall not be moved forever. The righteousness shall be everlasting, everlasting remembrance. He shall not be afraid of evil tidings. His heart is fixed, trusting in the Lord. His heart is established. He shall not be afraid until he sees his desire upon his enemies. He hath dispersed, he hath given to the poor, His righteousness endureth forever. His horn shall be exalted with honor. The wicked shall see it and be grieved. He shall gnash with his teeth and melt away. The desire of the wicked shall perish. So we see here that we have to fear the Lord. And a good example of that is back in Genesis chapter 22 with Abraham. Abraham feared the Lord. Feared the Lord enough that when God said, go sacrifice your son, he went was about to sacrifice his son, and God provided for him. Listen, Abraham was a good example of turning his life and turning his kid over to God. And just as you fathers, you have to turn your kids over to God. God is not going to expect you to put him on an altar and sacrifice him. But you need to lay him on the altar and say, God, he is yours already, but I'm giving him to you, or her to you. And to close out this morning, all fathers are going to fail. They're going to mess up. And there's only one perfect Father. He will never fail you. And that's our Heavenly Father. And to be an influential Father, we have to use God as that example. There's some great fathers in here. There's some in here that has absent fathers, abusive fathers. And this morning I want to point to you today to the good Father, who will never let you down. He's faithful and will never let you go. And to point you to Him, you have to look to Jesus. And trust Jesus that He died and rose again. Then you can become sons of God. Your father may be absent. He may be gone. But my Father, my Heavenly Father, He'll never leave you nor forsake you. So as dads and men of God, we must look to God for the perfect example He set. And to be an influential father, you have to live spiritually and intentionally. You have to love God intensely. You have to leave a legacy. Set that example for your kids. Let them see you reading this word. Let them see you pray. Read this word with them. Pray with them. Bring them to church every time the doors are open. There's one thing about my parents. If we was going to church and I didn't want to go as a younger age, guess where I went? Church. And Dad even says now, we ride down the road or something, and I may be going 60 mile an hour in a 55 or something, and he'll tell me to slow down. And I'll say, well, you done it. He said, when you get 58-year-old, you can do it too. That number goes up every year. But guess what? He set the example to be in church, to read your Bible, to pray. And guess what I love doing? I love coming to church. I love to worship. I love, even though that my nerves are shot by 9 o'clock when I wake up when I have to preach, I love to come up. I love to preach. I love to preach God's word because He set that example. He made me go to church on Sunday morning, and we had Sunday night then. And He made me go to church on Wednesday night, revivals and Bible schools. And if you want your kids to grow up godly, you have to leave that legacy behind. You have to be here every time the doors are open. You have to read the Word of God. You have to pray. Everyone, please stand and just bow your heads real quick. Come on up here, Jerry, and you mug if you want to play. As they're playing, I'm going to open up the altar. And if there's anyone here that as might have failed of being the dad or father or even mother that they need to be today. I pray that you'll come this morning and get those things right. And if you're here this morning and you failed, guess what? Today's a new day. You can start today being the dad or father that you need to be. You can, if you don't read with your kids at night or whenever, and you don't pray with them, you can start that today. You can start that tradition today. So if you would come. If you're here lost, and you don't know the Heavenly Father, today's your day too. We'll have men that come and can pray with you and show you in Scripture how to be saved. I'd like to thank you, Lord, for another day, Lord, that you allow us to come to your house this morning, Lord, just to worship you in song, Lord, just to be able to listen to your word being preached. Lord, I pray that the word has went out, Lord, and Lord, that the seed's been planted. Lord, I pray that whoever this was for, and that they'll heed to it. That they'll look to you for that perfect example, and that they'll be the father who you called them to be, that they'll be the husband that you called them to be, that they'll be the man that you called them to be. Lord, we know that fathers have a big role. They're leaders. And Lord, we just pray for each one here, Lord, that you would just bless them. Lord, that you would uplift them. Lord, that you would give them strength to keep pressing on. Lord, we pray for each one here, Lord, as we're going through a time, Lord, without a pastor. Lord, we pray for your guidance. We pray that your will be done. Lord, it's very easy for us to get within ourselves and get who we want or get who we like, but I pray this morning that your will be done. And Lord, I know if we have that heart, Lord, your will be done. Lord, we believe in you, and we're going to stand still, and we're going to see the salvation of the Lord. We just pray for each one here. In Jesus' name while we pray, and amen. I want to say a couple of things, and I'm done. If David don't want to say anything. So the next 2 weeks, we ain't having Wednesday night. Pray for me and Jill, we're going to be gone. But on July the 6th, the youth will be back up there. And if any parent or leader that is going on the trip with us on July 11th through the 15th, we're going to meet after class on Wednesday night to discuss some things. So if you're going, a parent, child, or leader that's going, we're meeting after class on Wednesday night to go over that. That's all the announcements I wanted to say. It's good to be in the house of the Lord this morning. I'm thankful for all he does. But as we depart, be much in prayer. Pray for each other. Love one another. Check up on one another. We're all going through something. And if you ain't going through something, you're going to be going through something. Check up on one another. Love one another. New, old, young. But you and Dad are looking good this morning. And I'm thankful for you all. Thankful for my dad, my grandpa, and the example they set for me. So I'm going to dismiss.